Hi there, Florin here. Today I have another DIY project. This time I want to water cool my GPU, a Radeon R9-290 car built by Sapphire. Some of you might say, why do this project when you can buy a Corsair GPU cooling plate? Well, the problem is that my card has a custom PCB and the Corsair plate won't fit it. The very first thing that I had to do is a bit of research on a certain component that I've seen being cooled by the original radiator. I contacted Sapphire, told them what I was going to do, and they kindly told me that the parts I'm looking at indeed need at least a passive cooling solution. To make this story short, after you take off the original heatsink, look at every thermal pad there is and be sure to put a radiator on that component. To start this project, first you need an all-in-one water cooler. I happen to have this one from my previous build, but you can get one for cheap in the second-hand market. I was able to find good coolers starting with 35 euros, and that includes a pump, the radiator and a fan. For this money you won't be able to buy anything for a custom loop build. Since my cooler was 3 years old and it has some stiff short tubes, I decided to first mod my cooler. But before all work started, I had to measure the tubing needed for the mod. I ended up with longer tubes anyway, that I eventually had to cut down later. Have ready some antifreeze coolant based on ethylene glycol solution for anti-corrosion and a bowl in which to spill the used liquid. First, I had to unscrew the copper plate just to check for possible debris. You can skip over this step if you're confident that the cooler is okay, but be sure to put the screws into a safe place. Since my cooler even after 3 years was in prime condition. After this, drain all the liquid left inside. For who's curious, this is where the water flows and this little sensor measures the pump's temperature. Now, simply cut the tubes just to have better access to the pump and then cut the leftovers the best way you can. Don't go too deep, not to cut into the pump's fittings. Do the same thing on the radiator side, but be careful not to dent the thin fins. It's not that important to have perfect fins, but they do let the air pass through for cooling, so it's better to keep them straight. Assemble the pump back and prepare everything for the new tubing. Inserting the tubes is easy, and you can secure them with zip ties. You can also use steel collars that have a screw on them, just like the ones you see in your car's tubes, but I think that's a bit too much. Also, keep in mind that you have to twist them into a good position for your final layout in the case. Time to measure how much liquid Corsair used in the H80i, but eventually I ended up filling the cooler with as much liquid I could, though I think you have to leave some air inside, but not that much. The filling part got pretty messy for me since I didn't use a funnel at start. Try to keep the mess to a minimum since I found out that this liquid is quite oily and it makes you a bit uncomfortable to touch stuff around. At start, the pump will rattle a lot due to air bubbles inside the pump. The way I got rid of them was to leave the radiator way up high and leave the pump way below. Now you can start the cooler. For this I used my USB hard drive rack and the SATA power extension cord. After you turn on the cooler, shake the pump a bit to make the air bubbles flow to the radiator. Because I did this project in 2 days, I left the cooler to sit for a night with the pump down and the radiator up. Eventually, all the air bubbles went inside the radiator, and now the cooler is silent when operating. Now for the passive cooling part. I've looked online for second-hand radiators and I found a sweet deal. This radiator cost me only 3 euros. And for the memory heatsinks, I ordered them on eBay from China. Also have some thermal paste ready. I use Arctic MX4 because it's good and doesn't conduct electricity. Start disassembling the video card and put all the screws in a safe location. These three little components also need to be cooled. On the VRM side, Sapphire did a great job and installed an additional heatsink, so I don't have to do anything here. The backplate I'll be using, so I won't remove it. The first obstacle was to find how to adapt the H80i pump to the GPU, since the brackets don't fit because the cooler is larger. I almost cut the Intel bracket to fix it, but then I remembered that the AMD one is a better fit, and it was. The only thing I had to do is make two holes. Now, for those three little components, I had to figure out how to build the radiator. I went through several versions, but eventually I ended up making an L-shaped heatsink out of a larger radiator that also helped cool several memory chips. This one I did off camera, but you can figure it out for yourself how to make the cuts, since they are easy. I did have to make a groove for the heatsink to sit over some components. This depends from car to car if you have to do it or not. Reuse the thermal pads and install the heatsink. Now for the pump. I had to put a nut on the screw as a spacer because of the bracket's hole being so close to a rounded corner. Apply thermal paste and install the cooler. Be smart and have somebody to help you here. Not like me, doing it alone, trying to keep the radiator up and having your hands shake to install the pump. Now install the heatsink for the memory. This is a must, as I found out that the GPU memory gets quite hot pretty fast while gaming, and you also need a fan to blow a bit of air onto them. Tested this by running a game and keeping my finger for more than 5 to 10 seconds on them without getting a burn. Use some thermal glue here, since the adhesive paste on these radiators kinda stink and they come off quite easy. To be sure till my adhesive comes, I had to put a bit of super glue on the sides just to have them secured. Initially I also installed a small fan on the VRM radiator, but I removed it later because I used another 140mm fan to blow air on the card to cool everything and do even less noise. Now install the GPU into the case. Like I said in the beginning, I had to cut some more from the tubing, and eventually I installed the radiator above the GPU. For the fans on the cooler, I used the pump's connector and Corsair link to configure how the fans behaves. Remember to connect the pump to a free USB socket for control. After putting everything together, I ran TimeSpy benchmark, and the temperature went to a maximum of 59 degrees Celsius. This from a typical of 77 degrees on the original radiator. Next, I started some games. I also seen a good improvement here. Having Battlefield 1 running at around 64 degrees Celsius, but when the radiator was in front of the case, it ran at about 60. Guess the CPU hot air impacts a bit the GPU cooler. On the original cooler, I had around 82 to 84 degrees Celsius in Battlefield 1, while running at 3440 by 1440, all ultra settings. The VRM are doing just fine, holding a solid 50 degrees down from 75. I also noticed a drop in power usage in heavy games like Doom. From a typical of 420 watts on the system, now with a cooler GPU, the computer needs about 380 watts to run the same game. Nothing changed though in the idle modes or casual web browsing. Now as a conclusion, I can say I'm not 100% pleased with the outcome of this project, because I was expecting a more solid temperature in the mid 50s, but I guess it also depends on how good the pump sits on my GPU and the fact that I have heat coming from the CPU into my radiator. I do have a better idea for the memory cooling, but this will take a little bit of planning, and I'll do another video if this materializes in any way. Like the video if you want me to continue doing stuff like this, and till the next time, see ya.